Your word is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. Let these words, let our reflections, our actions be light in the world. Amen. So today, I want to take you back briefly over the story. I want us to remember the family upon whom God has promised to build a great nation. Remember, the patriarch is the founder of three great world religions. So it's kind of useful that we kind of remember who this is, what this is about. So you'll remember, thanks for that first slide there, Rob, that's great. Remember that God said to Abraham, go out to a land that I will show you. So Abraham faithfully does that. He takes his wife, they were Abram and Sarah at the time, and then they go out and they become Abraham and Sarah, and they find this land that God gives them, and God promises that I will make you the father of a great nation, and I will be your God and you will be my people. That's the covenant that God makes with Abraham. Remember? And there were three visitors, and the three visitors say to Sarah that she's going to have a baby in a year. Only she's 91. She did the same thing. She all laughed like you. So remember that. But it happened, right? Before you move and slept. Don't forget, however, that this is the same patriarch and wife who banished the first son, Ishmael, and his mother, Hagar, who was the handmaiden or the servant girl of Sarah, because Sarah didn't want any competition between Ishmael and Isaac. Remember that? And so she got banished to die in the desert. Only God said, never mind, I'll make a great nation out of them too. So we don't hear from them again. But we know that something about God keeping a promise with them. Anyway, so we got Abraham and Sarah. Can I have the next slide, Rob? And they have Isaac, which means God laughs. That's what it means. And Isaac grows and becomes that guy, and it's time for him to find a wife. So he sends his servant out to his uncle Laban, who finds Rebecca. And if Rebecca says the right thing at the well, then the servant, well, that would be the sign that that is going to be Isaac's wife. And she says the right thing, and they do the right thing, and there's gifts exchanged. And so Rebecca comes back with Isaac, and they get married, right? And they have this life. Then Rebecca gets pregnant, right? She's pregnant. And these twins are warring inside her. Remember that part of the story? They're warring inside her. They scrap and fight so much so that Rebecca says, if it's going to be like this, can't I just die? And I'm sure every pregnant woman can relate to that. So, who do they have? Esau and Jacob. And remember the image of Jacob clawing at Esau's heel as they're born? Sign that they're going to be scrapping with one another. Well, do you remember that silly story when go to the next. Yeah, Esau and Jacob. You got it, Rob. You're awesome. You're with me. So Esau and Jacob, and Jacob tricks for a meal. He tricks Esau for his birthright. Remember, birthright is both a gift and a responsibility. But Jacob wants it, and he tricks Esau for it. Next slide. Not only does he trick it and steal it, he lies to his father that that's what he did. There's this story where, remember, Esau was hairy and Jacob was smooth. And there's this story when his blind father wants to pass on the blessing that Jacob puts on hairy some kind of fur sheepskin on his arms so his father can feel how hairy he is. And so the birthright passes. So not only does Jacob steal, he lies. But then he gets out of Dodge. It's probably useful to not be here anymore, right? Remember that? So next slide. And he goes to live with his uncle Laban. He meets Laban's daughter, Rachel. And he's gobsmacked. Okay, he comes to he falls in love with Rachel at a big time way. And he says, Laban man says, how, you'll work for me, but what will your wage be? And he said, well, I would like your daughter to be, I'd like to marry your daughter, Rachel. No problem. After 7 years of working for me, you'll get Rachel. After 7 years, he gets a wife. There's a wedding. Remember this? There's a wedding and there's a celebration. All the guests come. And in the morning, Jacob wakes up and makes a four-letter expletive because it's not Rachel, it's Leah. Oh my goodness. So the trickster has been tricked by his father-in-law. Then, right, we're getting this story. Then Leah, so he goes back to his father-in-law and says, what the heck are you doing? He said, if you work for me another 7 years and you stay a week in the nuptial week with Leah, then you can have Rachel. So he works another 7 years and he gets Rachel and Leah. Right? There they are. And then the babies come. Did you count them in the story? Like, Carol, there was a litany of them, and they come fast and furious, don't they? Like, man, there's a lot of babies. That boy is busy. So, let's see if we can do it. Leah has first four children. Well, let's do it in this order, because it just shows the pictures. First there's four to Leah, then one to Rachel's slave girl, then one to Rachel, then one to Leah's slave girl, and then Leah, and then Rachel, and then Leah, and then there's 12, and one's a girl, Dinah. There's 12. What do you know about the number 12? What's the number 12? It's not the months in the year. Say again. The tribes. The 12. 12, right? So he has all these kids. They seem to come after some 14 years, and they come fast. And then he decides he wants to go home. He wants to take all of his wives and his children, and he wants to go home. But Laban changes the stakes again. And he says, build up my livestock before you go, and then you can go. So Jacob, the trickster again, the story that Carol didn't read between the last sentence and there's about 12 verses in a convoluted breeding program for sheep. It has to do with striped and spotted sheep and the black sheep and the white sheep and whether they breed in front of the stakes, the white stakes that have no bark on them. Truly, I'm not kidding you, you can't make this up. It's in the Bible, right? It's in there. And so there's this convoluted breeding program that ends up with Jacob having all the stronger sheep and Laban having all the weaker sheep. So Jacob gets the last laugh on his father. We're going to meet Jacob one more time next week in a direct encounter with God. But I'm getting ahead of myself. Go to the, well, just notice that what's up there now and just look at it. Go to the next one there, Rob, and we'll go back to the title slide. Perfect. Except if we're not doing that yet. So my question for you this morning is, what do we make of all of that? That's not a rhetorical question. What do we make of all of this? What does it tell you about human behavior? Just pull her out.
The good, the bad, and the ugly, it's all accepted.
Good and bad, ugly.
If you need 12 tribes, you gotta get them somehow.
What does it tell you about human relations? Complicated. They're complicated. They're messy. What does it tell you about God?
He has a sense of humor.
That was in stereo. What else does it tell you about God?
Accepting.
Anything else? Each of us, each of us can tell our own family story, can't we? Each of us can sit in the front of a campfire and begin a sentence with the words, I remember the time when Dad was on the fishing boat and... Right? Each of us can tell a story like that. And your story will tell the family folklore. The details no longer are really important, right? If it was six kids or 12, or if it was at 3 o'clock in the afternoon or the year the drugstore burned down, right? It becomes folklore. The funny stories, the tragic stories, the stories of babies and deaths and celebrations. And with it, we will remember that through it all, the God that we worship, the one we call divine, and each of you will have a different word for that, the one we call divine keeps covenant. Think of your stories. The good, bad, the ugly. Go with them right now. Think of them. You know the one you don't want to tell, but you whisper it, right? In the kitchen. It's the story you tell in the kitchen about Aunt Mabel, right? You all have one of those. You might have two or three. Lots. I got lots. Through that folklore, God keeps covenant. We might write God. Also true is that in those stories about Aunt Mabel or all the stories that you want to tell in the corner or in the kitchen or over by the back fence, that story isn't the end. That's the really cool thing, is that these stories are attached to a legacy that we can never know the end of. We can see in a mirror dimly, but we can never know the end of that story. Because as Ecclesiastes says, God has put into the heads of humankind the past and the future, but can never know what God has from the beginning to the end. So what's our job? To eat and drink, take pleasure in all our toil. And in that, God keeps covenant. I will be your God, and you will be my people. And that's true for us. God will be our God, and we will be God's people. I think that's good news. Amen. Let's pray together. Holy God, this story touches us because it's the story of our family and the details different. May we hold our family stories gently, that we can let go of the things that no longer teach us about ourselves and cherish the things that help us to develop into who you would have us be. Bless us as we continue.